Well, hello everyone. This is a data-driven Formula One, and I have Patrick Hans with me here today. And today we will talk about Nino Farina. So Nino Farina is the first champion who won the Formula One championship in 1950. And in some other years, I have to say, but like, yeah, he was, since, you know, you probably heard the 1950 analysis from us, you know, this is kind of the logical continuation of that. And today we're talking about Nino Farina. And yeah, again, I would like to introduce Patrick Hens, who is going to be discussing this fantastic figure with me today. Hello, Patrick.
Hello, Dennis. Thanks. Happy to be back. And I think our general concept is doing one podcast about the year and then take on an interesting figure from that season, which could be a driver, which could be the team manager. I think also it can be an engineer or I don't know, whoever we decides who it will be. And for this time, it will be Emilio Giuseppe Farina, born October the 30 in 1906, mm-hmm. born in Turin in the Kingdom of Italy at that time. So really a long time ago, in fact, 114 years ago.
Yeah, I was going to say that luckily for us, what you mentioned, that the team principal, engineer, mechanic, and driver coincided for many people in, you know, you would be kind of your own team lead, your own engineer, your own driver back in the day. So now it that would be, you know, probably not, well, driver is one person, but yeah, the rest is normally there is large analytical team, there is large managerial team, there is large engineering team and all that. But back in the day, it was, yeah, just a handful of people. And the person who drove the car actually played an instrumental role, you know, from, you know, being a, yeah, being a driver, being a businessman, and also an engineer, and sometimes even a data scientist. So when we will talk about Niki Lauda, you know, this guy was definitely someone who also incorporated data at every stage of his decision making. So, but today we're talking about Nino Farina. So, shall we look at the brief summary of him?
Yeah. Of course.
So, yeah, so this is Nino Farina. So you can see his picture. And like Patrick mentioned, yeah, he's he was born in the 20th century. So we last time we discussed Luigi Fagioli, who is kind of my favorite person from 1950 season. And that guy was born in the 19th century. So Nino Farina is kind of the new wave guy. So he was born in 1906. But yeah, he was over 40, like Patrick has nicely pointed out last time. He was over 40 when he competed in the 1950 season. He was 44, right, Patrick?
Yeah, he won in the age of 44 the 1915 Drivers' right. Championship.
Mm-hmm. And another thing to note that you can see the death date, he died very young and he died in a car. He actually yes. died in a car. So this guy was, yeah, obviously cars and racing was his life, as we will see. Yeah,
but importantly, he not died in a race. He died in a normal street accident, unfortunately.
Yeah, exactly. But still, I mean that, you know, he, yeah, there was some aspects to that driving. Yeah. And yeah, I guess back in the day also we have to understand that driving was very dangerous, even if you were just driving a normal car. But yeah, I mean, he definitely, and we will see that he was in quite a few collisions throughout his career. Yeah. And he even drove a car in a condition when he just was in an accident, and he, like, the next day or something, he jumped, or several hours later, he jumped into a car and then participated in a race. So in a sense, like, you know, he, He reminds me some of the cool cycling champions who kind of, you know, you could have whatever injury and then get on. So for example, one of my friends is Mika Ives. So Mika Ives is several times world champion in cycling, and I know for a fact that several times he would have an injury, like he would break a leg or something, and the next day he would like jump on the bike and win a race. So that was kind of, I think, also the spirit back in the day, right? That you didn't kind of pay attention, because if you don't race, you don't get sponsorship for next year, and basically, yeah, you just needed, you had to do it, right?
Yeah, and but also I think important is the psychological factor. If you had a relevant accident, you have this fear going back that it could happen again, and the longer the break, you're not racing, maybe the bigger the fear gets. I mean, this is something which, for example, Nick Lauda mm-hmm. explained after his infamous fire accident.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So, and for some people, yeah, indeed, that was a deal breaker. So we will talk about several people, I mean, down the line that actually quit as a result of this, as a result of an accident, but not Nina Farina. Nina Farina was a character that basically, yeah, raced no matter what. Yeah, he was a very decorated champion in Formula One, right? So his first win was in 1950. His last win was in 1953, right? In German Grand Prix. So that's the win. Sorry. His last win was in 1953, and his last entry was in 1956. So he was quite he was driving for quite a long time, especially by the standards of 1950s, when you had probably, you know, people competing for a few years and you had a very quick exit normally, right?
Exactly, and the last entry 1956 was Indianapolis 500, and which is will be an interesting story for the 56 episode. Mm-hmm. One important point which we have here on our slide is education. So you said Farina was a person who ignored his accident and just jumped again into the car and drove again. Mm-hmm. But attention, he was not. This was not based, let's say, on stupidity or ignorance. In fact, he was the correct doctor of Farina.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know your sources. It's a little bit questionable where he had his doctor title. It seems mostly saying political science, but there are also other sources. He said he had a doctor in engineering, so I'm not completely sure about this point, but he had a doctor title. So he mm-hmm. was—he not only came from a quite medium upper class family, but also he had education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And another thing, I guess, that we need to mention about Nina Farina is not only did he put his own life in danger, but he was also, like, by some critics of Nina Farina, you know, he is normally regarded as a person who put other people's lives in danger, right? He was involved in the early career, he was involved in two fatal accidents where other people died, you know, he was basically, yeah, he was a very competitive guy. We have to understand, I mean, we're not trying to judge him, I just want to say, we're not trying to judge Nina Farina, we really respect him for who he was, but it has to be noted that, you know, it was not this kind of calculated risk person who, you know, would think, you know, okay, so will it hurt other people? Will I put myself and other people in danger if I do this? You know, he was basically the kind of guy who was like, yeah, I want to win. So at least this is what he appears like from what we know about his career. And so definitely that is something that we need to keep in mind when we talk about him, right? And and like we mentioned before, yeah, he obviously was also in several collisions when he was injured. He was injured. Yeah. He had a very 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 bright career in racing. Yeah, and he was an Italian champion for 3 seasons, and he was also the Formula One champion in 1950. Yeah.
And one important point which also we want to mention, maybe one of our spectators, listeners may think that Farina, the name sounds familiar. Mm-hmm. So he was the son of Giovanni Carlo Farina. Mm-hmm. This was the founder of a coach builder company, a small one, Stabilimente Farina. Not to be mixed up with his brother, who was Battista Farina, the founder of Pininfarina, the company still famous today, which designed very of the iconic Ferrari models. He came really from a famous automobile affine family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. So he also had this heritage, and I think the notable win, like the first notable win, was of course the Silverstone in 1950. I mean, apart from Italian championships, where he basically he emerged off, because we had Fangio, who was already a known driver, but in 1950 we actually, in Formula One competition, we actually saw Nino Farina. And there were also some I think in that season he really shined in terms of competing in Formula One, but he continued, and at one point he even was acting as a team principal, right, of Alfa Romeo, and at a later season. Was that in 1956, or am I Ferrari, yes.
I mean, he was the number one driver at Ferrari later on. Mm-hmm.
Okay, maybe I'm confusing that, sorry, but I mean, he was definitely, after 1950 season, he switched to Ferrari and even drove this Lancia car in 1955, which was also a very interesting part of his career. But essentially he was, he tried many different options to be fast.
Yes, and especially, I mean, the Lancia, the D50, I'm sure we will speak, of course, in detail about this, as he was the colleague with Alberto Ascari, and later this particular Lancia became the 56 Ferrari.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. We talked quite a lot about 1950 season, so do we want to maybe take it season by season and discuss over kind of his overall performance?
I would speak, let's say, more about in general the behavior is...
Let's do that. Definitely. So in terms of him as a driver, what do you think was the most important thing about him?
Maybe from a today's point of view, he may be a little bit forgotten, as as we had more iconic characters at in the 1950s, as Fancho, of course, as Alberto Ascari, but nevertheless, I mean, he bet in 1915 Fancho with an identical car, and as you said, Fancho at that time was like 10 years younger, but nevertheless, he was already an experienced and very strong driver, and you need really talent to beat such a driver. So really, Farina was a very strong driver, and by the way, he learned from one of the best, Tazio Nuvolari, who for many also is one of the best drivers of all times. For example, maybe we do someday a special edition, as it was much before the 1950s. Nuvolari won.
Yeah, people will hate us for this, because like if we name our like favorites, then they will have their own favorites. So, yeah, yeah. Like in terms of Hall of Fame, I think that would be very challenging. But we can try. We can try. Yeah, we can try.
Yeah, but let's say Nuvolari was famous for winning the famous Nürburgring race, but against the strong German competitors in the time of the Nazi regime, so a very political race, and what they called later the impossible race. So this Tazio Nuvolari was one of Farina's teachers, and so he really not only entered because he had the money to buy in the beginning a race car, but he really had very good teachers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. And yeah, like we said before, I think that me, he was a real risk taker. And sometimes that was, I already mentioned several deadly collisions, but we also know that in 1953, the Argentinian Grand Prix was fatal for spectators when he drove into a crowd, basically. Yeah, so I believe that Juan Perón was the president of Argentina at the time, and he allowed a free entry into the, racing corners, right? And there was a crowd standing basically at one of the corners, and Farina had to take an exit from a dangerous turn at the time. And yeah, he basically crashed into spectators and he killed 7 people.
Yeah, that's
several also got major injuries. Of course, it was not only his fault. Because it was the way the race was organized, right? So the organizers didn't take appropriate precautions, but you also could tell that this is the person we are talking about. He basically had to take this, so at an expense of other human life, he would still do it. He took that decision. That was an unfortunate decision, but he took it. He actually drove into the crowd at one point.
And I mean, to add here, I mean, I don't know if there's any TV material existing about that race, but you remember if you see the rally championships, maybe in the 1980s, the crowd, they had not been separated. They, especially in rally, you see that the some people, they even they have been like 1 meter away from the race cars driving this 200 kilometers. Sometimes they still have been standing before the cars when they're coming to take a good photo. So it was not only that the drivers taking the risk, but a lot of the spectators, they also took a very high risk of being to be near the race, to feel the race, take photos. So this is something which we saw, I think, until the 1980s, especially in the rally sports. I think it's not the idea to become a political podcast. Just to mention Juan Perón, famous outside Argentina, more famous had been his wife, Evita, of course. Juan, but also Evita, they had been fans of Italian cars.
Cars, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Famously, famously. Yeah.
Yeah, so Juan Perón had some very nice Ferraris, for example. And similar to the rulers in Europe, the dictators, he saw racing as one way to demonstrate superiority of the country. So that's why Juan Perón was also quite keen on organizing such events in Argentina.
Yeah, I mean, I understand now my, I'm just looking at my notes right now, peeping into my notes. And yeah, what I meant, of course, that he didn't become the team lead, but he became the leading driver, right, in Ferrari when Ascari left the team in 1954. So that's what I meant. Yeah, so then he basically took the leading seat in the team. And yeah, I mean, that season, the 1954 season, is very important because there were several major crashes for him, right? And basically Syracuse Grand Prix, right? Even he basically crashed pretty heavily. And then he also was in the faulty car in Belgian Grand Prix when ignition failed on a Ferrari in Belgian Grand Prix in 1954. And then actually his largest injury, he didn't get it in a Formula One race. He was racing Super Conte Maggiore Grand Prix, which is kind of a sports car race. Is that, can we say that that's kind of an equivalent to Indy, more or less? I mean, yeah, but that was not a Formula, the thing is, like, it was not the Formula One race. It was kind of like a quote-unquote regular car race. Yeah, it's a sports car race in Monza. And he basically was badly injured in that race, and he spent about 20 days in the hospital, so it was like almost a month in the hospital. And the important part was that in 1955, he actually started the season when he was basically taking very, very serious painkillers, like morphine injections, but he nevertheless was in the driving seat at that time, right? So that's another thing, like he during the 1954 he was in quite a few of these serious collisions, and in 1955 he was taken medication to drive, so, but he nevertheless didn't stop.
Exactly.
I guess we probably, unless Patrick, unless you want to add something else about the racing seasons, we could also skip ahead to his death, like how he died. But yeah,
I would like to shortly mention 1956.
Go ahead.
As this is, I think, an interesting chapter. As you mentioned, he was taking morphine because of his pains, and due to this, he could not return to Formula One in 1956. So he was out of contract, and also based on his age, he was already a little bit too old for this regular Formula One. Nevertheless, as we discussed in our earlier podcast, the US had been an interesting market for European manufacturers, so they thought how to market their portfolio in the US. And of course, now in 56, we have Indianapolis as one of the world's most famous races. I mean, you have the Triangle, the Formula One Grand Prix of Monaco, the 24 hours of Le Mans, and the Indy 500. So Ferrari at various points in time wanted to see how to participate in Indianapolis. This for the one reason to market the cars on the important market. And also Enzo Ferrari, he was always a very stubborn character. So many times he was in disagreement with the FIA and was seeing the opportunity to leave Formula One to join Indy Race. I think it was not, he never really wanted to leave. He just wanted to show I could leave if I wanted to leave. And with this, used this for the negotiations of the contracts.
Yeah, but also I think it was the dominance, right? I feel that there was quite a lot of rivalry between Italian car makers and American car makers back in the day, where Italian car makers were basically showing that, oh, we can produce this really elite, high-speed, cool cars, and they're so superior to anything. Like, we know this famous story with Ford versus Ferrari, that we now have a movie about it, I think. Yeah, so it's also that. But what I was really surprised to find out, to be honest, like in preparation for this, I didn't realize that in 1956, this Indianapolis 500, the Ferrari actually installed Curtis Craft chassis on the car. That was a surprise because I thought that they actually would race their own chassis. Is that because it was challenging to transport the car over to the States, so they had to take the local?
I don't know why in this particular race, because later on they used their own chassis.
Chassis, yeah, it's very, very unusual. I was very surprised.
Yes, but let's say for Enzo Ferrari, I mean, it was always about the engine. And I mean, he famously once said, I'm married with the 12-cylinder engine. For Ferrari, the chassis was never that important. He just, once he said, I'm selling engine and I'm putting it inside a car just to sell it. So for him, important was the focus on the engine, and maybe for technical reasons, as the Curtis Craft chassis was the quite experienced solution, it was the best idea to do it in that way. I mean, later Ferrari tried to construct the whole car. There has been two attempts later. One with Ascari and one in later on, which never have been realized, was at the end of the 90s.
Yeah, and also I think so here the important thing about 1956 season as well is that not only like there was this Curtis Craft chassis, but also Farino actually didn't qualify for Indianapolis 500, and we need to explain why that was, because like it probably sounds incredible, but back in the day, yeah, you needed to participate in qualifying to qualify for the race, and the problem was that qualifying was on over several days, and back in the day it was on I think four days, and the reason for that was that it was raining. During the qualifying, because it was heavy rain, it was very difficult to actually have all the drivers at the same time, so you needed to kind of run it in shifts because you didn't want to damage the cars during qualifying. That would be horrible, and that also meant that if you also chose to wait until the weather got better or for whatever reason, then you could potentially not qualify, and then basically on the fourth day there were just very few places to for the qualifying because the weather did not improve, and ultimately Farina did not qualify for that race. And then in 1957 I believe he tried to enter, right? It was not already not the Formula One racing, but it was IndyCar. But again, he just found it very, I think, challenging to drive. I guess it's a combination of age and, you know, the health problems that he was having. And ultimately, I think Keith Andrews, who was his teammate at the time, he actually had to finish the competition for him. Yeah, but he also tragically died that season, right? He was crushed to death between cow and fuel tank. So there was, like I said before, and like Patrick mentioned before, and
he even died in that particular Indianapolis 500.
He was in Indianapolis race in 1957. So that's what I mean. And so that was also, I mean, some of the some of the realities of the time. So you actually we actually think now, okay, well, you know, that yes, of course, Formula One cars and Indy cars, this is dangerous, but you know, the probability of dying is pretty low. But back in the day, you know, anything could happen, and you know, and mechanical faults, engineering faults could result in this really bad, you know, not on top of collisions and everything else that could happen. So that posed a serious risk for the, you know, for life of the drivers. Yeah, so and then basically after this 1957 attempt, I believe he retired, right? Pretty much he didn't do competitive driving after 1957. And he actually died, even though like Patrick said, he didn't die in the race. He was on the way to the French Grand Prix in 1966 when he died, and he lost control. He had a beautiful car. This is Lotus Cortina, fantastic piece of engineering. So he was in this car, and then he basically somehow, like, I don't think we know why that happened, but he basically lost, I don't know, maybe Patrick, maybe you know more, but he hit it. All I know that he hit a telegraph pole, that's all I know. But
it was better condition.
Okay.
It's quite curious that he drove a Lotus Cortina, because after he finished his career, he still stayed involved with Alfa Romeo, as he had a distributorship. I mean, he had worked at his uncle Battista's Pininfarina factory, but also he had a relation to British manufacturers, as he had a distributorship of Jaguar. So I don't know if the Lotus at that time was somehow related to Jaguar.
So we will obviously talk about this when we will talk about the 60s and 70s. But I mean, to me, also Lotus cars, you know, let's just curb the argument about the road car. High performance car. But when we talk about Formula One, Lotus is a very special team. I absolutely admire the engineering thought, and because this was a team that came, particularly if we look at 1970s, came and managed to beat the elders there, right? And McLaren and Ferrari were already very, very well-established teams at the time. And if we look at Lotus cars, they managed to completely overtake the entire competition. And my take on this, again, I don't know whether many people agree, and whether you would agree with me, Patrick, it was mainly, I think, because they had really brilliant technology behind the cars. And maybe that's why, you know, that's another reason why we have the fastest guy on the one of the fastest guys on the planet, driving driving one of the fastest cars and probably a very good piece of engineering. But yeah, I mean, it is ironic that it was not an Italian make, and it was a Lotus car. And we indeed need to look into, you know, what were the relationships between the
yeah. I mean, he had a Jaguar distributorship, so maybe it's via Jaguar, but I'm not sure if Lotus had been related to Jaguar. I think not, but honestly, I don't know.
Yeah, not that I know about that either. But we will, like I said, when we look at kind of later seasons, we will find out. Okay, so we've talked quite a lot about technology. So I guess we could go to the next rubric now. And that's behavior. And yeah, I think we pretty much covered that as well. But in terms of, like I said, in terms of character, this was kind of this completely unstoppable guy. And nothing stopped him, not his personal injuries, not injuries of others, not even, in being involved in fatal collisions where other people died and even spectators died. So that didn't stop him. I mean, I guess that also shows you the determination and how important this was for him, right? So not everybody after crashing into a crowd would actually get back. Like psychologically, you had to be very strong, I think, to be able to do that. And I guess it also shows you the level of abstraction in the sense that, you know, there is reality of racing and there is reality of life. And I think he probably was really keeping these two worlds really separate because, you know, there's anything could happen in a race. But, you know, in his private life, like you said, he was a very educated person and, highly decorated guy in terms of a racing career, very popular. So all of these things basically tell you how he managed to separate the two things psychologically so that he could actually continue racing until pretty much he couldn't literally get into the car and do it anymore. And he probably, he was in such an age that he decided that, okay, well, you know, maybe this is time for me to retire. But actually, you know, the fact that he died on the way to a racing circuit also tells you that he didn't kind of leave his passion even after that, and he was he was a fan of the sport and he would go to the races. Because I think, very few, like if you think about, professional athletes, for example, they are professional sports people, they very rarely, unless only if they're invited, probably attend, competitions. And, to see that level of involvement and dedication is, I think, is very rare.
Yeah, I can... I mean, you can say he was a classical racer, somebody who lived for racing. He was highly talented. As we spoke shortly in the last podcast, I think he was still part of the gentleman's driver who bought their first car. Mm-hmm. And then had been able to be part of a professional race team while bringing in not only themselves as a driver, but also the car. Mm-hmm. For example, Alfa Romeo, at that time they had the big Scuderia Ferrari as he worked for the company. But this time they had the professional drivers which received the cars from the company, but also they had been a group of gentlemen's driver who had been part of this same team, but they had to bring in their own car. But this doesn't mean that the gentleman's driver, they only had been part because of the money. Some of them had been highly skilled, and this is, I think, true for Nino Farina.
Yeah, we will talk about at a later stage about the guys who basically made their own cars. And, you know, to me, like, one of these guys is, of course, Williams. Like, we will talk about Williams team in detail. But, like, you know, the amount of, like, innovative thinking in a very constrained environment that this guy showed, that it was absolutely incredible. And some of them, of course, you know, that they had to, you know, if you don't find sponsorship, you had to be very, very innovative. And I guess that's also part of this journey. Like, you have to understand during each race what is needed, what changes are needed to be made, and that was a very important part of this journey.
Exactly, and as you said, I mean, he was very hard inside the race, but a gentleman outside the race, something which you may observe up to an extreme, I think, with Ayrton Senna, as he was not only a gentleman, he was highly religious, but his partner Gerhard Berger once said, in one moment he explains you the Bible, and the next moment he drives over your head. So this is something which we see right from the beginning up to modern times, I think.
Yeah, that's right. So I guess that's that kind of takes care of behavior. And we normally, Patrick and I, find different legacy phrases for the end of the video. But this time, Patrick found a genius quote by Enzo Ferrari.
Yeah, I thought. One important point in work is you don't have to invite the wheel every time, but there's a lot of data. And I mean, this is what our podcast is about. So you find data, information, knowledge from other people. So I thought Enzo Ferrari resumed it quite good. He, as he said, a man of steel inside and out, but I could never help feeling apprehensive about him. He was like a highest young thoroughbred, capable of committing the most astonishing follies. As a consequence, he was a regular inmate of the hospital ward. So I think exactly what we all covered speaking about his behavior.
Yeah. I mean, this is kind of like a bit of a hybrid between a bad boy and and a highly determined champion. Yeah, so definitely. And quite a controversial figure, you know, but at the same time, I think what we will talk about, some of the drivers who would do anything to win, you know, you could say kind of you could say about Nino Farina that like some people would believe that he would do anything to win, but I think that's not entirely correct. I think he still, like, there was this like you said, this kind of gentlemanly side of him. But at the same time, yes, I think there was a separation between a kind of he could really separate this kind of Nino Farina in real life and Nino Farina in racing. And in racing, he probably was a completely unstoppable person who would do anything to win. But, you know, in other circumstances, like, you know, he was, like we said, very successful in finding sponsorships, very successful in making the right connections to become the lead driver for Ferrari team. That takes, it is a very, very difficult field to negotiate. So you need to possess certain, you know, features of character. So you need to be very good communicator. You need to be not just very good in what you do, but also you need to be able to convince people. I think convincing Enzo Ferrari was probably a very difficult job. but you know, he managed to do that. He managed to do this. You know, he took opportunities when they were there. And he actually managed to, yeah, I mean, we could admire him for his determination and getting back into the car after, you know, being in this really horrible collisions. But at the same time, we kind of could look at him as a very controversial and quite scary figure for the fact that, you know, over racing, like during the racing, he could easily kind of sacrifice lives of other human beings, but he was putting his life in danger as well. We need to understand that it was not like he was just trying to kill everybody else off to win. So that's, I think, the important part.
Yes, I agree, but I don't know if it was that completely different to other drivers at that time, as maybe all of them had been aware that it's very dangerous.
Yeah, they were a bit crazy.
Not only for them, but also for spectators, for example. So, I mean, maybe, and I mean, here we are speaking completely speculative, as we don't know, cannot know this, of course, but maybe everybody at that time could have been in that particular accident. I completely agree with you that he was a hard driver, but due to our investigation, I think he was no person who overstepped the lines, the rules, as for example other famous drivers later.
Yeah, that's right. I completely agree. So yeah, we need to always make, you know, I think there is always a danger to judge people from kind of today's view, right? There is an acceptable behavior today. But back in the day, the reality was completely different. Yeah. And, you know, it was very real to go to a Formula One race or any other race for that matter and not come back. So that was the reality of life. And while we are not kind of from the current, it's always better. It's always easy to be smart in retrospect and say, you know, these guys were kind of ruthless, win maximizers or something like this. But yeah, I mean, this was the reality they lived in, and it was.
Yes, and, in a sense, maybe one point I'm just thinking of. I mean, we are speaking about. He was famous before and after the war, and I mean all these drivers they experienced the Second World War, so they maybe all had been in situations where they could have lost the life at any point, being a soldier or experience bombing, whatever. So they, I mean, all people at that time they experienced the war, at least in Europe. So It was a situation where you could lose your life, had been unfortunately a reality for them.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, we just need to always understand that. And again, we're not making a judgment here. We're just presenting, you know, the facts. So this was the figure. Yes. This was the historical fact. He was like this. And right. Patrick said, many of these drivers had to take these difficult decisions back in the day because, there was just no other alternative sometimes. And it was the only rational thing to do in those circumstances. And yeah, there were some really unfortunate incidents as a result of the state of the world back in the day. So I guess on this note, that I was a man of steel inside and out, we will end it here. And yeah, thanks a lot for being with us today.
Yeah, thanks a lot, and stay with us.
Thank you, and see you
later. Thank you. Bye bye.